Coming to the last talk of this first session that is given by Stephanie Weisser and Olivier Lartillot. So I have introduced Stephanie already, so some words about Olivier. So everybody in working in MIR knows Olivier. The MIR toolbox was mentioned already. He's right now a research fellow in Jyväskylä in Finland. He just also finished 12-month research visit in Geneva. And welcome, Noé. And they're going to present a talk on investigating non-Western musical timbre, a need for joint approaches.
Again, I'm back. I take this opportunity to do something I forgot last time, is to invite you all to come to the museum in Brussels. It's a very nice museum, and please let me know when you're there, I'll give you a tour. Okay, so let's get back to the work. So I will present you a teamwork, we were just talking about this, focusing on non-Western instrumental timbre. So among the non-Western timbre, one category is particularly of interest, at least for me, it's the buzzing timbres. These timbres are used in numerous instruments belonging to varied cultural areas, including the European medieval and Renaissance art music, which is now completely forgotten. This study is part of an ongoing research project at the Musical Instrument Museum in Brussels, focusing on these timbres produced by string instruments. And in the framework of this project, several instruments have been analyzed. This presentation will focus on the sitar, the well-known plucked lute from North India. So the sitar is a long-neck lute with movable curved frets from North India. Several types of sitar exist, but they present some general characteristics, among which we can name the three categories of strings: the main strings, the sympathetic strings, and the drone or rhythmic strings. The main strings are played with the left-hand fingers stopping them, contrary to the drone, which are always played open, and the sympathetic strings, which are not played at all. As their name suggests, they are set into vibration by the other string's vibration. So all these strings are placed on a wide, slightly curved bridge called jawari. The sitar is equipped with two jawaris, one for the main and one for the drone strings, and another one separated one for the sympathetic strings, as you see here. So this jawari mechanism, which is responsible for the very specific and recognizable sound color of the sitar, is also present on other Indian string instruments, including the drone lute tampura, the tube zither veena, etc., etc. It has intrigued researchers since the pioneer work of Sivri Raman in 1922, and several studies regarding this mechanism have been conducted. However, most of these studies focus on the description and or the modeling of the string vibration induced by the constraint that is the edge of the bridge. Basically, they don't say much about the sound. So according to the musician, the jawari can be adjusted according to two main different settings: khula, that means open, and band, that means closed. So to give you an example, the archetype of the khula jawari is the sound of Pandit Ravi Shankar, or sometimes the sound of the drone lute tampura. For the band jawari, usually, Ustad Vilayat Khan and Pandit Nikhil Banerjee are cited as references. by the musician themselves. The problem is that only extreme positions reach consensus, especially when it comes to define an intermediary position, which is called gol jawari. In practice, this situation is thus very complex. But whatever the setting chosen by the musician, the jawari is indispensable to the sitar. So, in practice, the jawari is performed by skillfully and lightly filling some area of the white bridge with sandpaper or things like that. The angle between the edge of the bridge and the string is of the utmost importance. In this picture, you can see the sitar maker Barun Roy from Calcutta showing the location of the area to file in order to close the mainstream jawari on an unfinished sitar. This was taken in 2011 in Calcutta. Due to the string's pressure on the bridge, the angle between the bridge's edge and the string tends to change in time, and the maintenance of the jawari must be done regularly, depending on how much you're playing your instrument. But for a professional musician, it must be done every 1 or 2 months. So the jawari work is made by an expert, either the musician himself or a maker, but in that latter case, the musician is always involved in the process and tests the instrument during the jawari work. So the study of the sitar's jawari effect presents several difficulties. First, there are two jawaris, and they both contribute to the global sound of the instrument. And a closed jawari for the mainstream does not automatically imply that the taraf jawari will be closed too. You can have one that is open, one that is closed. As the sitar is a virtuoso instrument, there are a wide variety of playing techniques impacting the global sound, such as plucking direction, precise location of the plucking, strength, etc., etc. And all that is when we consider only but one string, but the sitar performances require the use of varied techniques and musical situation, and the instrument is truly used to the full extent of its possibilities. So, so here is an example of a musician
playing kula jawari.
Jawari, the closed jawari.
I have to stop because the full performance takes about an hour. Sorry for the quality of the images. So several musicians were asked during informal interviews about the setting of the Jawari during a fieldwork conducted in 2011 in Kolkata. And the analysis of their statements showed that, first, that balance is very important. The Jawari must be balanced between with the general construction of the instrument, whether the instrument is light or hard. That's one major point. The second was that there must be balance between the general sounds of all the notes of the instrument. They must not be all identical, but they must fit well together. And in general, Jawari setting is a question of balance between roundness and clarity. Roundness is usually used to describe the effect of the Jawari on the sound, but too much roundness might contribute to confuse the clarity of the melodic line, as the following notes of an excessive round note might be jumbled up. So interviews also provided information regarding extreme incorrect settings, which were very useful. For example, a Jawari that is too much open, too kula, was described as nasal, but too closed, too bent, for example, was called not a sitar anymore, but a guitar. So we have the extreme. So finally, several adjectives used to describe the sounds were collected. For example, kula was described as lively, treble, sharper, warmer, whereas bent was rounded, sounding from the inside. So this fine-tuning seemed to be very important for musicians, and they can devote a considerable amount of time to get it right. However, the limits of the classical ethnomusicological investigation were reached without providing defining information. Therefore, a joint approach, a teamwork, was used. And we used for that several sounds that are presented here. And I will now let Olivier, or you prefer?
Have you finished explaining about the sound?
Yes, I will just say that it was the sound that were used for these studies were collected in Calcutta in 2001. You had a musician playing kula Jawari, musician playing band, and another the same one playing also kula for an experiment. That was the two corpuses of sound. And
so this collaboration is a kind of work in progress where you try to understand what kind of timbral description could explain this difference between this open and closed Jawari. And so we try to consider different timbral descriptions, some that are already quite classical, and for instance that I could use using a mere toolbox. And then we saw the need to add a new improvements and new features to see more in detail how the sound evolve in this particular Jawari sounds. And so far, in particular, I will develop here some explanation about this important concept of auditory roughness, since it plays a very important role in such instruments. And also the idea that it's interesting to see the dynamic evolution of this roughness during the sounding of each note, and to have some description of this dynamic evolution. And then this idea of formants, because of course this it has been said that this sound have a use of can be described by a vocal description such as voyelles descending formants. There was in the interview conception of nasal sound and so on. So I will show a little about this later on. How we could use formant tracking to check this. And then finally, more some other aspects of dynamic evolution of the spectrum. Maybe I just go. And so let's. I just changed my. This. About roughness, so there have been lots of research about how to describe and to have computational description of roughness models. And first, it's often considered as based on this aspect of beating between closed frequencies. And there have been perceptual studies showing that if you have two sinusoids of very close frequency, so let's say here you have the different interval between this pair of frequencies, then you can predict how you will perceive an aspect of roughness of the beating between these two frequencies. So if it's unison or octave, there is no real dissonance, sensory dissonance or roughness. But if it's, for instance, one semitonal difference between the two sinusoids, then the roughness is very high. So you have this curve, like this in prompt and level studies that predict this roughness for every pair of sinusoids. And so then computational models of roughness for general sounds. One very usual approach is to start from the spectrum, compute the frequency, Fourier frequency transform. So you get this distribution of energy along the frequencies. And now we look at the different important peaks in the spectrum, and we consider each pair of peaks. So let's say, for instance, you have these two peaks here and here, with the two frequencies Fi and Fj, and the two magnitudes Mi and Mj. And then now we can predict for this pair of frequency the roughness. And then the idea, for instance, in the usual set theorist model is to sum for all these pair of frequencies their corresponding roughness. And to sum, but to multiply by the energy of these two frequencies. But here we can notice that that could be a problem, because if, for instance, you have a very large, high amplitude for this frequency of this sinusoid, but a very lower amplitude for this second frequency, actually the beating between the two might be related to the energy of this second frequency and the first one. But this very high frequency for the first, the highest energy, is maybe not so important, the fact that this higher, this larger frequency has a very high amplitude. So a variance that we could consider, so that I suggest here as calling a Cetharis mean version, is instead of considering the magnitude of the two pair of sinusoids, just taking the minimum of this amplitude. And then there is another recent research about modeling roughness that is much more complex, with an interesting consideration based not only of these beating frequencies, but also of modulation of amplitude. Issue of that is that the perceptual validity of this model still needs to be grounded, because it's a very recent model. But so we have these three examples of models that could be considered. And so these three are available in Meertens, and we have computed so the roughness curve for each of the examples of the sound excerpts. And now we see the interest of this modification of the Cetharis model. So if you take the initial Cetharis model for a particular sound, you have first a very high roughness at the beginning, a very high peak and a very sharp drop. And this is due simply to the fact that at the beginning some of the frequencies are very high amplitude because it's the attack of the sound. But actually, this has no effect really on the roughness. So now if you take the mean model, you see that there is not such a high amplitude, because actually you can see the scale. Now this difference of roughness can be compared to this scale of roughness. So this means that we have now removed this very important peak at the beginning, because it's not really related to roughness. And then we see a very interesting increase here of roughness, and this shape that maybe more corresponding to what we perceive as the sensory dissonance. And then the Vasilakis model that show more complex pattern. Usually, I guess, for the different examples, the pattern are more complex. And okay, so now we can compare the roughness, dynamic evolution of roughness for open javary and closed javary. So maybe I could play again the sound of open javary.
Respond to this curve. Another example, still of open javary. Play again the second example. And this is the second one. Okay, so now I go quickly. And this is closed javary. And we see that for open javary, we have a more important resurgence of the roughness. I have to go quickly, but we then compare the general evolution of open javary and closed javary by simply superposing all the curve for open javary and closed javary and normalizing the curve, and we see that for open javary we have a lot of resurgence of this roughness. See that the roughness starts at 1 here and also at here, so for closed javary it's basically a decrease. But for open javary, you have this important resurgence of roughness. This is maybe not so interesting. But then for Forman tracking, actually, what we propose is to reuse this general model of Forman modeling used in the voice processing, but removing what is adapted for voice. So usually for voice, for Forman analysis, then there is a pre-emphasis filter that we don't need because we don't need to consider the particularity of the vocal system. And also here we can allow the possibility of tracking not only three formants as in voice, but you can have five formants like in this one. You have a more higher number of formants. And also other generalizations that make it possible to see nice description like here. And so it's also included, we will include the Meertens box, so if people are interested, they could also try to see a formant description of pieces like this. And then our last tentative is to show, maybe this is better, from the spectrogram, a description that show that for particular frequencies, you could see a resurgence of energy. For particular frequencies. That is not clearly seen directly from the spectrogram, but if we just track local minima and then track the part in each frequency channel where the energy is higher than this local minima until it reaches again the local minima, then we get this very interesting connex region showing that here you have increase of energy. So that's a different visualization that we were developing to see into these particularities of sound that we were studying. So last word.
Just a last word to say, as an ethnomusicologist, we are facing some limits in our work, and it was extremely fruitful and very grateful to Olivier for understanding the problems and the situation so well and finding the right tools and models to go further than what I could do. So thank you.
We have time for perhaps two questions. Short.
From what I know, some of these models, especially I think the Vasilakis one, is a model for roughness in voice, if I'm right.
I'm not sure because in his papers he really mentioned studying instruments from different countries. And
okay.
He mentioned also Indian music.
I'm just
and
what?
Also double oboe.
Okay.
And everything like that, yeah.
I was just wondering if then all these models which might describe roughness in voice, for example for voice pathology, if this is the right thing we, when we apply to musical instruments, if you want to look for roughness, is that the same roughness? Are we speaking about the same thing then?
It's noise, right? Pathology in voice is related to noise. And
well, I know that in pathology, that they in voice, they look a lot at jitter and shimmer phenomena and then the excitation of the voice, for example. It's the question. I mean, it's not an excitation problem here. So
maybe here, if you take the jitter of the L0, that is very, very stable.
Yeah.
So maybe jitter. But yeah, that could be looked.